These magicians use their skills to rob a whole-ass bank. Goddamn.
Come in close.
This is J. Daniel Atlas, or Danny, showcasing his card handling and internal monologuing skills. The more you think you see, the easier it'll be to fool you. He elaborates how sight works and how he uses our attention against us. A roundabout way of explaining how sleight of hand and misdirection works. You see, he's a street magician, which has this lady all hot and bothered. Pick a card and remember.
Closer you look,
the less you see.
His dad probably owns the building. Nonetheless, the trick is met with cheers and applause as we zoom into a suspicious, hooded person. Next up is the amazing Merritt McKinney, a mentalist. Basically, he can read your mind and hypnotize you. His talents prove to be authentic, as the lady he's working on can neither move nor speak. Merritt moves on to questioning the husband, and using subtle facial cues and twitches, he unveils that the husband cheated on his wife with Janet, her sister. The man panics and agrees to pay $250 to reset his wife's memories. But he won't be getting off that easy, literally, as Merritt has now made it so every time he thinks of Janet, he'll picture Merritt in his birthday suit.
And wide awake.
Just like that, magic is real. The suspicious person is also here, which is suspicious. The third magician is Jack Wilder. He does a basic spoon bending trick and is immediately found out. He's forced to cough up $100 like he agreed to at the start of his act, but in the process, hits a quick lick. As he makes his escape, he bumps into Mr. Hoodie.
My wallet. Watch!
Got him. We have a fourth magician. This time, a female Houdini, Henley Reeves. It's time for a hot tub stream and her Sims are loving it. Okay, but really, she needs to escape from the water tank before hungry piranhas are poured into it.
A lady has to have handcuffs, right girls?
Fun fact, apparently the actress actually almost drowned while filming this scene. Her panic is genuine. She struggles to get out. And then, suddenly, the water turns into cranberry juice as the hooded person looks on. Then, Henley appears amongst the crowd, dripping wet. We come back to Danny's room where he's about to show the girl from earlier a new trick. He calls it, hide the pickle, but then, he spots a card and kicks her out.
You're such an asshole.
Easily the least believable part of the movie. We cut to a montage of all the other magicians finding similar cards with an invitation on the back. The date arrives, and on her way there, Henley runs into Danny. Looks like they know each other, but this isn't a happy reunion. I'm gonna go inside, scope the place out, and you wait out here.
Not your assistant anymore.
And I know you've been stalking me on my website. Danny tries to play it cool as they run into Merritt, who's surprised that more people were invited. As they get acquainted, Merritt helps them with their baggage. You're a control freak, and that's why you're no longer a couple. The ex-partners deny this before Merritt creepily chimes in that Henley,
you deserve to be made to feel special.
Thankfully, Jack arrives and turns out he idolizes Danny. Might as well start calling him Daddy. Anyway, they show off their cards. Death, the High Priestess, the Lover.
3 minutes.
Yeah, she went there. And finally, Hermit. The four rejects, the four horsemen, are complete. Jack may have arrived last, but he's definitely not least. He easily unlocks the door and the place is filthy, but whoever recruited them left a note. Then, Henley places this rose she found in the vase and triggers some more magic shenanigans. They start pointing fingers as to who set this up. They look for answers before Merritt successfully turns on a hologram of sorts. Apparently, it's a blueprint to a show. Fast forward a year later and that blueprint has been realized. The four horsemen are now famous. At tonight's big show, we prepare to witness the final trick of the night, robbing a bank. Yeah, screw banks, just buy NFTs, right? Just kidding, this is not financial advice, and God, yes, that's right, Morgan Freeman is my witness. Also, no recordings allowed, okay? Okay, psych. Anyway, the crowd gets even more hyped as they help the horseman pick a random volunteer. B513 is selected, and Etienne introduces himself. You guessed it, he owns a bank, but it's in Paris, which flusters Danny.
We were hoping for something a little more local.
The four horsemen give thanks to their friend and benefactor, Arthur Tressler.
The only man here with the Queen's cell phone number.
He is, after all, a knight. No, seriously, he is. They shower him with a few more praises, and the crowd follows suit with applause. Meanwhile, whatever that was. Then, Jack brings in a stylish and elegant teleportation helmet, which will allow the Frenchman to teleport, mic, speaker, and camera included. Merritt figures out the bank's address and they let Etienne pick a card and let him sign it. Henley does a little curtain magic, with the help of CGI, of course, and the device appears. This is Etienne's portal to Paris.
1, 2, 3.
Everybody is shocked until he appears on screen. He's in a vault with millions worth of euros in front of him. He's instructed to drop the card and his ticket in the pile of cash. and with the press of a button, he can transfer all of it to Las Vegas. At the same time, bank employees head towards the vault as Entian presses the button and the money starts to get sucked up. The vault is opened and all that's left is Entian's card and ticket. Back in Vegas, money starts pouring down to the crowd's excitement. Hell yeah! We cut to FBI agent Dylan Rhodes, who gets a call about the magicians. At the other end is Agent Fuller, ready to apprehend the four horsemen. Even in cuffs, all four are still met with applause. Looks like Dylan is irritated at being assigned to their case. Look on the bright side, man. You have a beautiful French Interpol agent as your partner. Dylan is somehow unbelievably angry at this, but the agent, Alma, is more optimistic. She already questioned Entian and found him useless. Dylan is annoyed. You spoke to my witness before me? He really is always angry. That was a Hulk reference if anyone's wondering. Anyway, Alma counters that Dylan didn't even want the case. They proceed to the interrogation and Entian is convinced the magic was real. With Dylan's cue,
bullshit.
Merritt's hypnotism kicks in and Entian can't help but practice his air violin. No one can stop him, so Dylan walks out. Alma follows. I was ordered here to provide a report, until we have one.
I'm here, like it or not.
She proposes to work together to not waste time. You wouldn't like her when she's angry. Dylan laughs it off but cooperates in interrogating the horsemen. They start with Merritt, who somehow flashes a cheeky glance and smile through a two-way mirror. Magic. Fuller nervously warns Dylan not to believe everything he says. Huh, weird.
Men wearing dresses?
No shame, Agent Fuller. No shame.
Oh, goddamn. Dylan sheds light on Merritt's heyday. He was a once-famous mentalist that got screwed over by his brother/manager. Merritt laughs off his past and turns the tables on the agents. Is this your first date? You should be aware that he has abandonment issues. Mommy? Daddy.
You have big daddy issues.
Don't be annoyed. It's free therapy. Danny's interrogation is a bit different, as he showcases not just his tricks, but his arrogance as well. You won't arrest us because if you did, it means that you, the FBI, and Interpol believe in magic. We'd be even more famous and you would look like idiots even more than you already are. Dylan tries intimidation tactics, but fails. Danny is fully confident that they'll always be several steps ahead of them, and taunts the agent, resulting in...
I'm gonna nail you.
All that talk. Maybe you're thirsty. First rule of magic?
Always be the smartest guy in the room.
The interrogation concludes with all the horsemen set free. Dylan is now fully invested in the case and berates his boss for letting them go. Then, Agent Fuller brings in some good news. The show was packed with paid fillers, but they were able to pinpoint Thaddeus Bradley, aka Morgan Freeman, who filmed the entire stunt. He debunks magicians, exposes them. He knows how they do their tricks. Dylan sets off to meet with him. Thaddeus was apparently one of the best magicians, which explains this movie. But let's start with the wine trick for now. That's incredible. That's amazing. Dylan pretend sucks up to Thaddeus and asks why he stopped being a magician. Basically, money. He sold way more DVDs than he did tickets to shows. The need to know is greater than the desire to be fooled. And like you,
I detest those who prey upon the gullibility of the masses.
Alma pries into the downside of these exposés. Lives, careers, ruined. You're referring to Lionel Shrike, an average magician who drowned in the Hudson River. Alma has done her research. She knows how Thaddeus' DVD special led to Lionel's attempt at a Houdini-esque escape. He died trying to do something he wasn't prepared to handle. Thaddeus dismisses their concern for Lionel and ridicules the agents for being fooled. My special comes out next month if you still want to know how they did it. Dylan threatens to arrest him and challenges whether or not Thaddeus actually knows anything. And with that, Thaddeus must flex his skills. The gang pull up to the stage before Dylan dons a teleportation helmet. Say the magic word. Abraca.
Blow me?
Close enough. So, it was a trapdoor to a fake vault under the stage. Thaddeus enters and explains how Entian was selected long before the event, hypnotized and tricked into going to the show. And they didn't rob the bank, but most likely a truck. Freshly minted money just waiting to be taken. As far as the real money, they replaced it with fakes made of flash paper. No smoke or residue left behind. In Arthur's private plane, he Skypes with Conan. This was before Zoom took over. Conan compliments the horsemen, giving the audience $3 million really worked out for them.
They're gonna be the first magicians in history to get laid.
Flying in the economy class like the rest of us are the agents. Dylan is still at a loss and is curious of Arthur and Thaddeus' connection to the horsemen, while Alma practices card tricks. They get to chatting with Dylan explaining that he hates people exploiting other people's weaknesses. Namely, the need to believe in something unexplainable to make their lives bearable. Religion.
I see it as a strength.
She succeeds in her card trick, and just look at that smile. Dylan is gonna start simping, isn't he? I can't really blame him. She do be kinda cute. Back in the private jet, Merritt unpacks more of Henley's baggage. Her unrequited and misplaced affection for Danny. Merritt jokes that he could be her personal corkscrew. Though his advances are denied, he does still manage to make her laugh, which is always the first step. Their conversation gets interrupted by Danny, downplaying Merritt's mentalism skills. It's just a bunch of tricks. Anyone could do it. All right, why don't you give it a shot? Arthur overhears the conversation and volunteers. I can be quite difficult to read if I want to be. Well, let's put that to the test. Danny reads that Arthur was a tough kid with a tough dog, Ben the Bulldog. Arthur corrects him.
I was a pretty little tot.
And he had a fluffy white cat called Snuffles. Danny doesn't back down and tries once more, this time guessing his uncle's name. Humongous? No, Danny. It was
Cushman Armitage.
I wonder what that was all about. Despite the failure, he reassures him that the show will be much better. Cut to the agents who find a place to stay thanks to Alma. So the least you can do is listen to her, Dylan. She's been researching multiple magicians in order to understand how they think. Alma tries to tell Dylan about Lionel Shrike, the man she mentioned earlier. He took a signed card and made it appear encased in glass inside a tree. Dylan is too tense for a history lesson and leaves. At least Fuller has good news. The horsemen wear tracking bracelets, for no reason at all, that the FBI can also track. Alma joins Dylan on the balcony where she opens up about one of her favorite pastimes. There's this famous bridge in Paris where people make a wish, place a lock on the bridge, and throw away the key. She likes to sit there and watch them do it, but not in the fun way. And so, their secret is locked away forever.
Real and, at the same time, magical.
Oh well. Dylan speculates that there's a fifth horseman as we cut to Thaddeus' recording. There is a legend of secret order in Egypt, the Eye. They use magic and illusion to even the scales of justice. Are the horsemen the next fools to believe this myth? He questions whether or not the horsemen can get away once more. Suddenly, Arthur appears, rudely interrupting him. He offers him $3.5 million to
fly away.
Thaddeus rejects the offer. You're in this to ride them up?
I'm in it to ride them down.
Arthur burns the check and intimidates him with his wealth and lawyers. However, Thaddeus remains unfazed while Arthur continues his threats. Thaddeus warns him, one who uses a doll to enact one's own wrath is likely to bring that very wrath onto himself.
And I thought you didn't believe in magic.
He's got a point. Before the show, Meredith is still trying to get into Henley's pants, which catches Danny's full attention. Thaddeus drops by to wish them luck and insult their belief in the Eye. You've made it far for a bunch of wannabes and has-beens. Merritt quickly deflects the insult and starts reading Thaddeus. A little boy wanted to be a great magician, but wasn't good enough. He's at the bottom of the food chain, feeding off those who have the talent he never did.
Am I getting close?
Thaddeus remains silent, so Danny tries a new card trick on him, but is quickly interrupted. It's up your left sleeve. Nope. Check your dumb pocket. Oof. Gotcha. Brutal.
Thank you so much for coming by, but this is kind of a talent-only area, so...
Break a leg.
Onto the show, we see the crowd taking their seats. The agents also arrive and Alma finishes the story to Lionel Shrike's tree. He was just 14 when he found a tree with a peculiar hole in it. He made a guy sign a card and put it in the hole. 18 years later, at the guy's retirement party, he performs a trick and by then, the tree had grown around the encased card. Wait, that isn't magic? The tree grew.
The point is, the trick was not to look closely. It was to look so far that you see 20 years into the past.
Okay, whatever. Also, Shrike's body was never found, so could he be alive? The show finally starts, and this time, cameras and recordings are allowed. The horsemen publicly shame Dylan and Alma before getting out of the performance. Is what follows 100 different tricks, or is it just one giant illusion? Different tricks follow. A disappearing rabbit out of a hat, and a hat out of a rabbit. Yep, we're just making shit up at this point. Then, Merritt hypnotizes 12 audience members, and Jack shows off his card skills. Merritt's hypnosis involves tackling the quarterback, which shall be the person who shouts, freeze.
Kill the quarterback!
Oh, okay, I see where this is going. Next up, we have some aerial stunts, with a little spice.
I guess you have lost some weight.
Is this a compliment? Alma is enjoying the show, and Dylan is his usual brooding self. Time for the finale. Merritt begins to set the mood. He instructs the crowd to take out the envelopes where they've written their current bank account balances. He selects names from the shouting crowd and accurately recites their bank balance. Although, he tells all of them that what they've written is actually incorrect. God, I hope so. The rest of the horsemen join Merritt and they once again thank the rich old guy, Arthur. They invite him to the stage for the finale while the agents look on with bated breath. Jack takes out a huge check with Arthur's $144 million net worth. Although, Merritt reveals that this amount is also wrong. He lets the crowd use the flashlights on their seats to warm up their paper to let the correct balance appear. Jack brings along a massive torch for Arthur's. His big old balance begins to decrease by 70,000, as an audience member cheers as her balance increases by that same amount. Arthur's account keeps decreasing while more and more members find their numbers going up. The horsemen confess that all the audience members were chosen. They all have one thing in common. They lost their homes and businesses to hard times. And got boned by their insurance company.
All of you were insured by the same company.
Tressler Insurance.
This is all for show, correct? Well, exposing corrupt business practices certainly makes for a good show. One person confirms the magical transaction to be real, and the entire crowd is thrilled upon checking their phones. Arthur rages at the spontaneous donation, but the horsemen agitate him even more.
We don't have your password. It's not like we can answer security questions like your mother's maiden name or the name of your first pet.
Oh. Got him.
Hey, we left you the jet.
Oh, okay.
The four horsemen prepare to leave, and the crowd boos Arthur. And there goes his pretty wife. Gone with the money. The FBI confirms what's happening is real, and Dylan springs into action.
Nobody move!
Freeze!
Uh-oh. They make a fancy exit while Dylan gets dogpiled, but not in the fun way. Alma, on the other hand, does a better job at running after them. Back on his feet, Dylan gives chase and uses the FBI's tracker. The horsemen prove to have great cardio as Dylan can hardly keep up. Though, Alma manages to catch up to Danny.
Stop!
Nah, you ain't gonna do it. Danny escapes her grasp but is soon tracked down to a bathroom. Or not.
I'm fracking myself!
He was the source of his problems all along. Relatable. The news media poke fun at Dylan and the FBI's underwhelming performance. Two robberies in 2 days and no one is in custody. Later, Alma catches Dylan drinking and is worried about him. But Dylan is suspicious of her sudden appearance and more importantly, she let Danny go. Who exactly are you?
I'm Batman.
Just kidding, Dylan gets a peek at her notes. What's the Eye of Horus? Alma ignores his question. You're dismissive enough about me when you're sober. Bye. Arthur is also drowning his sorrows and invites Thaddeus for a chat.
What's your role with them? You seem to know everything about them.
Thaddeus tries to console him.
This wasn't about you. You're merely the distraction.
I was $140 million distraction.
Yep. Arthur demands that Thaddeus exposes them, destroying them once and for all. The price? $10 million.
Am I flinching?
Didn't you just lose all your money?
Anyway, Dylan gets back to the apartment to find a book next to his sleeping Alma. He takes interest in the Guardians of Horus and does a little reading. A now awake Alma surprises him and he apologizes for his drunken behavior. Alma admits that Mare was right. She's indeed a desk agent. A researcher, but that's what she does best. They discuss the Eye, protectors of magic and its practitioners. They deduce the horsemen might be candidates for their initiation, following commands with blind obedience. It might be a myth, but some things are only discovered
if you take certain leaps.
They centrally lock eyes before cutting the moment short. Then, Dylan discovers that his phone's acting up. Fast forward at their mobile headquarters and they find his phone's been bugged. Someone has heard every call, read every text, and that's how the horsemen have always been ahead of them. They review Danny's interrogation and spot the exact moment he replaced Dylan's phone.
Look at that cheeky face.
Dylan rallies his troops, as this time, they're the ones ahead. The bug has been traced to New York City. Time to cut off their phones, electricity, and water.
Squeeze them out. I want them to feel our presence.
Me, fighting the rats that live in my walls. Come back to the horsemen, getting rid of plans and evidence. A nervous Jack gets assigned to stay back and burn everything. They're all anxious despite telling themselves to stick to the plan. Suddenly,
they're here.
Outside, we see that Alma gets left behind, due to the patriarchy, as the FBI storms the building. Danley, Merritt, and Henley get out safely, but Thaddeus is quietly following them. How'd you like your horseman, Arthur?
Shredded.
Back inside, we bear witness to Jack's magic moves. I see he must have taken in Dale's survival training classes.
You little shit.
He flawlessly mimics Dylan's voice and diverts the rest of the FBI elsewhere. Fuller is panicking as Dylan tries to catch Jack, who does a little disappearing trick mid-fight. Who knew magic had combat applications? Jack has more up his sleeve as he whips out his card arsenal. His skills are too OP and he gets out. Though, Dylan doesn't give up so easy. Outside, we can see that his partner is just as persistent as she jacks this man's whip. Meanwhile, Jack's too slippery and gets past these two agents before borrowing their car. Alma rolls in just in time, but before they go,
if you don't trust me, tell me. Promise me next time you'll back me up.
Dylan is forced to make the promise and spots Thaddeus filming from behind. Fuller is looking worse for wear but gets the rest in formation. Jack demonstrates once more that he's a jack of all trades by easily outmaneuvering the FBI. The high-speed pursuit reaches a congested bridge where... Ruh-roh. Dylan attempts a rescue but gets pulled out before... Rip in peace. Supposedly. Jack is reported dead as the rest of the horsemen contemplate their next move. Dylan is told that the paper he took from the burning car held some valuable info. But before that, Thaddeus calls him to sow chaos. He likens Alma to that of the magician's assistant. That lovely innocent is actually pulling the strings. You see, Thaddeus believes Alma was not chosen by mistake for this case.
Why are you helping me?
Just trying to even the game. I feel like I'm playing with somebody wearing ankle weights and flippers.
Keep up, Agent Rose. Keep up.
Back to the FBI, they connected the papers to a private security contractor who's hiding close to $500 million.
I didn't ask you.
Daddy, chill. The money is hidden in a vault inside a warehouse in Queens, which may be the Horseman's next target. Apparently, the Horseman got the classified documents from Dylan's mobile headquarters. Thanks to the codes in his bugged phone, all these continuous failures lead to him losing the case.
I'm taking over.
He's upset and takes it out on Alma. If I find out that you're anything other than what you say you are, I swear. But she dismisses him and asks for a little more faith. Unfortunately, Dylan is emotional over losing the case, so he ignores her and her feelings. Kinda based. The FBI rushes to the warehouse, but the safe is already gone. Apparently, Common gave the orders to move it.
This is bullshit!
And with that signal, our rapper has now turned into an air violinist. Talk about talent. Dylan chases after the truck carrying the safe. They catch up, but instead of checking its contents, they decide to escort their truck to its destination. On the way, they watch the remaining horsemen's recording of an emotional tribute for Jack and an invitation to their final act. We stay rhyming. And yes, we're watching YouTube on YouTube. Which is at least double the cringe. At the venue, the crowd begins to flock just as the FBI arrive. The truck they're guarding gets approached by a confused Thaddeus with his crew. Dylan confidently accuses Thaddeus as the elusive fifth horseman. Of course, he denies this and berates them for being idiots before challenging them to open the safe. What's this?
No! No!
Who doesn't love a good magic trick?
The FBI has been fooled and it's been caught in 4K. DVD coming soon. The FBI quickly make their way towards the show. What is magic? Magic is deception. Deception designed to delight, entertain, and inspire. It is about belief, faith, and trust. The horsemen continue the speech on their high-tech hologram that magic should not be used to cheat or lie for personal gain and greed. They disappear as special effects surround the building and the FBI gives chase. Alma stops Dylan and convinces him to take a different route.
Take a leap of faith. Okay.
Back to the horseman, Meredith is horsing around about how they first met.
I thought you were kind of a dick.
They banter a little bit, wondering what they'll do next since this is the last task from the eye. At the rooftop, the FBI are duped by mannequins. In time, the real horsemen appear. Dylan and Alma are on the scene but can only stand by and watch as the horsemen bid the crowd farewell. However, Dylan chooses violence. Fortunately, Alma stopped him from shooting in a crowd full of people.
Come on, man.
Anyway, we proceed with cheers and applause as money rains down, much to the FBI's disappointment.
Well, I guess that's it.
Is it really? Before that has a chance to escalate, Fuller alerts Dylan that the money is fake. Cut to Thaddeus, who receives a bittersweet surprise when he opens his car. The horsemen emerge from the subway to Times Square, and perhaps this is the eye giving them their approval. Now we see Thaddeus locked in a cell, and Dylan pays him a visit.
I've been framed.
He immediately suggests that he can prove it. Dylan doesn't buy it. In his free time, Thaddeus reveals that he has deciphered their entire trick. The warehouse was turned into a giant version of the disappearing rabbit trick. The safe was not transferred, only hidden, and it was broken into only when it was all clear. The money taken by none other than Jack, alive and well. All four horsemen were on the bridge during the accident, driving different vehicles and providing enough distraction for the old switcheroo. Look at that stash. Also, Jack's body was likely just some dude from a morgue. Despite these revelations, Thaddeus acknowledges that he's still at a loss as to the purpose of all of this. Was it really just an elaborate and dangerous plan to frame one person? They didn't even keep any of the money. Dylan doesn't find any importance in what Thaddeus said. He instead pieces everything together starting from Lionel Shrike's accident, the insurer that denied the family's claim,
trust their insurance,
the bank that carried the note,
Credit Republican of Paris.
Thaddeus is befuddled and shook. Meanwhile, the four horsemen reunite in Central Park. They head to Lionel Shrike's tree with the card encased in glass. They take out their cards and it all comes together to activate the carousel. Back in the cell, Dylan speculates that the eye has been watching and waiting for truly great magicians to appear, and that Thaddeus is bitter for never being invited. Instead of destroying the eye like he wanted, Thaddeus only pissed them off.
The eye isn't real.
Who could be behind this then?
Thaddeus can only come up with someone prepared to sacrifice everything. Someone meticulous enough to not be considered a suspect until the trick was over. Dylan demands a name, but nothing comes up. Thaddeus thinks to himself,
they were always one step ahead of me, and the FBI, consistently. It must have been someone on the...
inside.
I was the imposter.
We come to learn that Dylan was behind it all. Later, he reveals himself to the horseman at the carousel.
Welcome to the eye.
So sorry for kicking your ass.
It's okay.
Sometime after the events, we catch up with Alma at that famous bridge. Her newspaper is filled with Lionel Shrike's incident. Suddenly, a wild Dylan appears. He provides clarification on the Elkhorn Safe Company's connection. They used cheap steel, leading to Lionel being trapped underwater when the steel warped during his safe trick. Turns out, Dylan is Lionel's son. He keeps his father's memory through his watch.
From that moment on, I created a persona. I planned. I worked out every detail.
The one thing that I couldn't imagine happening was you.
This is stupid. He ponders whether Alma will arrest him, but she's not on that snitch life.
One more secret to lock away.
Okay, at least we got a cute ending.